So welcome and good evening, everyone. It's a great pleasure to welcome you here this evening. My name is Peter Henry. I'm Dean of the school. We have a very exciting program planned for you tonight. It is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce Dr. Henry Kaufman, a member of our Stern family and one of our most distinguished alumni. Now, if Henry's name is familiar to many of you, it's for very good reason. You're actually sitting in his building. The Kaufman Management Center, in fact, and it is a strong indication of Henry's generosity to the Stern School and more broadly to NYU. Henry's been a strong supporter of the Stern School of NYU for a very long time. He served as a member of the Stern Board of Overseers. He's currently a member of the Board of Overseers. He's chairman emeritus of the Stern Board of Overseers, and he's also a member of the NYU Board of Trustees. Henry is an alumnus of our PhD program, having graduated in 1958. He's one of those rare academics who not only has a brilliant mind, but also has extraordinary business acumen. This is reflected in his illustrious career. Henry is the president of Henry Kaufman and Company Incorporated, established in 1988, specializing in economic and financial consulting. Prior to starting his own company, he worked for 26 years at Salomon Brothers, rising to be a member of the executive committee and in charge of the firm's four research departments. And finally, is the vice chairman of the parent company, Salomon Incorporated. Before joining Salomon Brothers, Henry was in commercial banking and served as an economist at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. A highly proclaimed and prolific writer, Henry is also the author of The Road to Financial Reformation, published in August of 2009. Prior to that, he wrote on money and markets, a Wall Street memoir, which was released in June of 2000, and Interest Rates, the Markets, and the New Financial World, released in 1987. Which was awarded the first George S. Eccles Prize for Excellence in Economic Writing from the Columbia Business School. You may have heard of it, small school uptown. It is with great honor and privilege that we welcome Henry tonight back to the Stern School to talk about his highly anticipated and most recent book, Tectonic Shifts in Financial Markets, People, Policies, and Institutions. There are copies of this book that you'll be able to get later in the reception that will follow this event, but this is my copy. So please, let's first of all give Henry a very warm NYU Stern welcome. And interviewing Henry is Kim Schoenholtz, professor of management practice and director of the Center for Global Economy and Business here at NYU Stern. Kim started his career as a market economist at Salomon Brothers in 1986, working in its New York, Tokyo, and London operations. He was named Salomon's chief economist in 1997 and subsequently became chief economist at Salomon's with Barney and at Citigroup. It is at Salomon, in fact, where Kim and Henry crossed paths for the first time, working closely together. So it is with great pleasure we welcome him here back to Stern today to make that connection and sort of close the circle. So Kim, over to you.
Thank you very much, Peter. Thank you all for being here tonight. This is just a great pleasure for me personally and a great honor to be chatting with Henry about his new book. And I'm looking forward to you all reading it when you get your copies at the reception downstairs. We plan to chat for about 40, 45 minutes about the book, and then I'm going to ask all of you to join us downstairs at the reception. I look forward to meeting all of you. So to kick it off, Henry, here's a sort of a softball beginning. The book, which you'll all see rather soon, is dedicated to Sidney Homer and Marcus Nadler. I'm wondering if you could say a few words about them and about why you've dedicated it to them.
Well, thank you. First, let me thank the dean and you for again being here for another one of my books. And I want to thank a couple of people. We have here David Cecilia, who has been my editor on my third book, and without him, this couldn't have been accomplished, to say the least. I see also my secretary and assistant sitting here, who has been with me for 50 years and has kept me on the straight and narrow, Helen Catcher. And of course, that is only... that has only been exceeded by the presence of my wife, who has tolerated me for 60 years. Now, I will tell you a little bit about Marcus Nadler and Sidney Homer. Marcus Nadler was the most prominent and dominant professor at this year's school from the 1940s, the 50s, and the early 60s. Without him, I doubt that I would be actually sitting here today. He had a profound influence on my career, on my thinking, just to indicate to you the extent to which that prevailed, Professor Nadler taught a course in money markets domestically and internationally, and his most popular course was Current Economic and Financial Problems, which was attended by students who were matriculating and many, many students who were not matriculating anymore, who came back every week to sit in a large classroom which held at that time 250 or so students. And they were back every week to listen to him talk about the current economic and financial problems. And in those days, which was unusual, everyone got an outline of what he was going to talk about. Now today it's much more prevalent. But there also was a cadre of people eventually that formed around him, students that he had, senior executives of business and financial organizations, particularly Wall Streeters, that joined into an organization called the Money Marketeers. And he was the spiritual leader, and we met three times a year for dinner, and it was a fun dinner with all kinds of skits put on. Not that Professor Nadler participated. He was a very serious man, serious lecturer, to say the least. But Marcus Nadler became my thesis advisor for my doctorate, and he had insights which were exceedingly interesting and perceptive. I will only give you a couple of illustrations. He took great care paying attention to his students. As I was proceeding along trying to get my doctorate, some of you may know that in order to get a PhD, at that time at least, you had to have an oral examination, and you sat in front of six professors for 3 hours. So I went in to see him, and he said, "Now, Henry, I want you to visit each one of these six professors, introduce yourself, and you've got to read everything that they have ever written." ever written. And then I want you to think about the following. He said, "As you are there for 3 hours, you're going to be questioned. You are entitled to hear the question and think about the answer. You are also entitled to speak slowly. But if you speak quickly and respond quickly, there are going to be more questions in those 3 hours." Which was very sage advice, to say the least. Now, as to my career, he had a great influence in where I was going to land up. I remember I was at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York at the time for a number of years, and I got a call. The government of Turkey wanted someone that would help them set up a money and capital market in Turkey. Elaine and I had just gotten married, and it sounded like an interesting thing to do. For 2 years, we'd been Ankara, traveling around the Middle East. Why not? So I went to see Marcus Nadler, and he said, "Now look, you're going to come back after 2 years. Whom do you think in New York wants an expert on the Turkish money and capital markets?" I forgot that. I'll give you one other illustration. I was at the Federal Reserve, and the Franklin National Bank was about to move to New York and try to become a participant in the money and capital market, become a big competitor to the other institutions here. And Mr. Roth, who was running the bank, wanted somebody to help him. And it sounded quite interesting. I went to see Marcus Nadler, and he said, "Now, Henry, you're right now at the Federal Reserve. If you go there, it's not clear whether Franklin National Bank is going to be a success or a failure. You're going to take a real chance. And I thought about it, and I declined it. Well, a number of years later, as some of you may know your history, the Franklin National Bank failed. And then when I had, as you will read from the book, when I got the offer from Salomon Brothers, I walked in and he said to me, "I know why you're here." And I said, "Why am I here?" He said, "You got an offer from Salomon Brothers," because the partners knew him exceedingly well and they must have checked up on me. I did have an offer from Salomon. And I said, "What do you think?" And he said, "Well, you can stay at the Federal Reserve and carve out a very nice career over time. But if you really want to go into Wall Street, this may be the right place." And I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, you will soon find out whether you will sink or swim. It's not competitive. And number two, at Salomon, you can hear the cash register ring every minute of the day." And I joined Salomon Brothers. And I could tell you more related stories about Marcus Nadler, an extraordinary individual. But let me turn over to Sidney Homer. Sidney Homer was the man who I worked for initially when I came to Salomon. And Sidney Homer was a very unusual individual. He came from Scudder Stevens and Clark, where he was a senior portfolio manager. But that's not the background I want to tell you about. Sidney Homer's mother sang with Caruso. Sidney Homer's uncle was Samuel Barber. Sidney Homer was a distant relative of the painter Homer. And so he was a very classical man. And here, Salomon had hired, a year before I came, this very classical man who was in the midst of all these traitors. Not all of them of my partners even had, at that time, college degrees. Most of them did. They certainly weren't graduates of Harvard, which Sidney Homer had graduated. But Sidney Homer was a very unusual individual in many ways. He had a set routine of behavior and associating with people. After I was there for about 3 weeks trying to get going, Sidney Homer walked into my office. Offices in Wall Street at that time were like this, at least for the juniors, and came to my office and he said, "I'd like you to read the galleys of the book that I've written." And Sidney Homer had written a book called A History of Interest Rates from 2000 BC to the present time. 2000 BC to the present time. And I said, "Well, yes, how would you like me to do this?" He said, "I have two galleys." "Two galleys, yes. I want you to take one, and I want you to give the other one to your secretary." And I said, "Yes. But I'd like you to read it out loud to your secretary." I said, "Yes." And I said, "Why do you want me to do that?" And he said, "Well, if you read it out loud, you will understand much more whether the sentence structure is right or whether it's cumbersome. You'll find errors," and so on. So I took the two galleys, my secretary took one, I took the other, and I read 580 pages of the history of interest rates from 2000 BC to the present time. And I also read 82 statistical tables with all the numbers on them. And that was my introduction to Sidney Homer and to a more detailed evaluation of interest rates, which I was associated with for quite a number of years. And he was an extraordinary individual, and he had a style of writing and working, which was a great example to me. Anyway, that's the long introduction to the two people whom I've dedicated this book.
Thank you, Henry.
Sorry.
Well, this book is less than 561 pages.
Thank God.
And you don't have to read it out loud. But I was wondering if you could tell the audience, what are the two or three top ideas that you would like most readers to take away from Tectonic Shifts?
Well, I think it's important for teachers, for market participants, for Americans generally to appreciate that financial institutions and markets play a unique and important role in our society. It's very critical. They bring together, as your teachers will tell you, they intermediate. They take temporary funds, savings, and they lend them out to other institutions, to business corporations, to other borrowers, governments, and so on. And that is a very, very crucial role in an advanced society. Financial institutions have a special role, therefore. They have a fiduciary responsibility to all of us. And at the same time, they have an entrepreneurial drive. They want to make money. And they have to balance that entrepreneurial drive with their fiduciary responsibility and weigh it very, very well. When that fiduciary responsibility is not protected, and when the entrepreneurial drive really lifts up, the system gets into trouble. And that has been the case. And we haven't had the right guidance mechanism to give to balance that fiduciary drive with the entrepreneurial drive. And so at the same time, the guidance mechanism hasn't been very good. So we get into trouble in the 1920s when the fiduciary drive landed up into a speculative drive. And we get the Depression. We get all kinds of legislation to try to rebalance financial institutions, to perform in a more orderly fashion than they did in the 1920s. We got the Depression. And then after we had all of this rebalancing, we went into the post-war period, and gradually, we demobilized that structure again, and the entrepreneurial drive took over, and the fiduciary responsibility gradually was forgotten. And as a result, we got into the serious setback of the speculative boom of not too long ago, of 2006, 2007, and the great problem that we got into in 2008. And I have to tell you, those problems are deeply embedded in my mind, partly because of my own personal background. As you may or may not know, I came here as a 10-year-old, washed ashore here, and avoided the Holocaust as a victim of a Holocaust in 1937. But for years and years, my grandfather talked about the hyperinflation of the 1920s, the extent to which it robbed the middle class. It was just stories where buckets of money came in to pay off for merchandise bought. Difficult to really appreciate and to understand, but I heard these stories on and on when I was 9 years old, 10 years old, 11 years old, from my grandfather. And of course, coming here to the United States, we appreciate it. But we were, all the people that lived in the 1930s were the victim of the 1920s, of the speculative excesses of the 1920s. And when you have lived through that period and experienced that your father goes to work making very little money in the 1930s when we got here, it left an imprint on me, very frankly, that the financial institutions can contribute, if they don't watch it out, and we don't have effective supervision and oversight, to capsizing an economy and a financial system which can lead not only to economic change, but potentially to great political change, as it did in Germany at the time. So I've always been really sensitive to that and probably biased in that way.
Thank you. We're very privileged to have Paul Volcker here tonight.
Where is he?
I mentioned that because I'm...
Oh, chill. Sneaking away.
You want?
And I mention that because I'm going to quote right now from Paul Volcker's foreword to the book. Let me quote. "One of the important lessons of Henry's books is the degree to which those in financial markets have lost their way." So my question is, what can be done to restore a sense of personal responsibility in financial firms and markets?
Well, I think a lot can be done. I'm not so sure. I'm afraid a lot will be undone. To begin, schools of learning, business schools, have a great responsibility. And I'm not so sure that responsibility is carried out as much as it should be. To teach the future leaders here, at this school and at other school, of what financial responsibility is all about. How do those who go into the field of finance and banking and investment banking, what should they realize? That they have a dual responsibility. It isn't just the last trade that counts. It is the extent to which they understand that they are there to protect the savings and the longer-term investments, the short-term investment of the public at large. I'm not so sure that's taught very well today at any business school or at any school as such. The teaching of financial history is very critical. At least you can learn from the financial buccaneers of the past how they did, why they did wrong, and why those mistakes were noticed early. What were the failures of past legislation and restraints? I think that's a very critical beginning to the whole process. Now then, if you ask me what else can be done, well, for example, I know in the latest publication that this school brought out, I would agree with, we ought to have high capital requirements for financial institutions, higher than they are today. I wouldn't argue against that as such. I do think we might bring back something that prevailed when I became a partner. When I became a partner at Salomon, Sidney Homer called me and he said, "Next week, Bill Salomon is going to call you in and offer you a partnership." I said, "God, that's great." And he said, "However, I want you to tell your wife, Elaine, something." And I said, "What is that?" And he said, "Well, next week when you sign the partnership papers, you're going to be personally liable for $2 billion. $2 billion. And so when I told this to Elaine, "I'm going to be personally liable for $2 billion," and she said, "What do you want to do that for?" I would require the senior management of financial institutions to have a personal risk. They should be personally liable. I don't know how far the chain I would go, but I think they might act differently. And I would, and any awards they get in stock or deferred payment ought to be deferred all the way out there and not handed over the moment that they quit the establishment, and make them more understanding of what their responsibilities are. I would urge the regulators and supervisors to hold periodic lectures to the senior management of all institutions and point out every year what their responsibilities are. And if they don't perform and adhere to those responsibilities, to their the fiduciary responsibility, the entrepreneurial drive will take care of itself. But their fiduciary responsibility, drill it into them. That's not the case today. Now, we have every year now, there is this review every other year of major institutions and their shortcomings and so on. Well, I would have the central bank put a credit rating next to each institution. Whatever there used to be a CAMEL rating, as Paul will explain to you years ago, but I would have a credit rating. You know, isn't it kind of strange that we are here today in the United States where there is not one commercial bank that has a AAA rating? In the 1970s, there were 15. Now, how can that be, that there's been such a deterioration as such? It shouldn't be allowed. Wouldn't it seem logical that a financial institution of great prominence should be highly rated, higher rated than most of its clients? So if you didn't have the deposit deposit insurance, where would they be today? There ought to be a price that has to be paid for it. You know, there is a deep concern here that credit isn't going to flow, that we have to liberalize more, let institutions do their thing. I've never seen a period in which credit didn't flow, at least in the post-war era as such. It is the direction of the magnitude of the credit flow has been great. As all of you realize, the growth in debt of business, of households, of governments, and so on, has exceeded the growth of nominal GDP for years. Now, that can't go on forever as such. And so when there is a fear, we're going to restrain the growth of credit, that's not true at all. That is a political kind of slogan, but it's not true in the numbers. Anyway.
Henry, I want to ask a question about how you discipline people in financial business. So this is early in the book. You're quoting or describing the Solomon brothers under Billy Solomon. Under Solomon's leadership, the firm held strict limits on partner salaries and on the withdrawal of capital. Woe to the partner who approached Billy asking to withdraw above those limits. So the question is, how can financial intermediaries today discipline their star employees? Isn't the risk that they just leave and go someplace else?
Well, yes, there is that risk. And if they commit excesses somewhere else because of what they want to do, so be it. Now, I will tell you an anecdote, okay? This was in the 1970s sometime when we were sitting in the executive committee, and a young man came in with a slip and he handed it to Bill Solomon, and Bill Solomon announced that we had just done a $150 million bond trade with a large institution client. $150 million bond trade in the 1970s was a big, big trade. And so Billy asked the young man, what did we take out of the trade? We had take out of the trade, meaning we acted as a dealer and not as a broker. So we were at risk for taking in $150 million in bonds. And I think the trader said 1 point. He said, Bill said, we took out 1 point. So he said, well, send in the partner who handled the trade. And the young man came in, he was a relatively young man. And Billy asked him, what did you take out of the trade? 1 point. You took out 1 point? He said, you know, we don't do that. I understand all those bonds were high quality bonds. This is an important client to the firm. You go back and give him what he's entitled to out of that 1 point. And then he said, so that you remember that, we're going to reduce your participation in the profits of the firm at the end of the year. Now, that was how you deal with excesses in the system. Probably today, in such an instance, the man in charge of the organization would say, you only took out a point. You should have taken out a point and a half, as such. But that's, it was a different style. That is what you call relationship banking. Today, we advertise relationship banking. It's not the same thing. So the management itself has to be much more, has to be more of a patrician, has to have a little bit more of an oversight. Not look at every trade, but think about what the institution is about. Now, I will also tell you, Bill Solomon was very interested in enlarging the capital of the firm. So as you indicated, if a partner wanted to, so we got money, we got a base salary, we could draw out some money to pay taxes, and we could draw out some money to make charitable contributions. If you wanted more money than that, and you went to Bill Solomon, you didn't hear the end of it. But he remembered it, and he didn't take it very kindly. That same ethos is not applicable today, unfortunately. In fact, instead of building capital, you want to leverage capital. Don't have as much equity in, let's put up more debt, because the more debt we pile on, the more is the potential for earnings dropping to the bottom line and splitting it. I don't know whether you may have followed this up with another question, but I have another idea that came to my mind. Back in the year 2007 or 8, just before the problem was created, Chuck Prince, who was then the head of Citigroup, was asked about what they're doing and the problems, and he, it's in the book, he said something like this: as long as the music plays in the financial markets, we have to be on the dance floor. Meaning, as long as there is a profit to be made and business to be done, we at Citigroup have to be in there doing our thing, bidding. Now, you ask yourself, what did he really mean by that? Well, what he really, I think, did not elaborate, but I suspect what the reasoning for it was, well, we have to be out there doing that business. If we don't try to garner that business, there's a potential we do not make as much profit. And if we don't make as much profit, our traders and investment bankers cannot get the compensation they would like. And our stockholders also may be disgruntled a little bit. So whatever happens, we got to be out there to the extreme levels of making markets, taking extreme risks to satisfy a near-term constituency. That's the danger in the financial market, of tilting over into entrepreneurship rather than recognizing your fiduciary responsibility.
Henry, turning to a new topic, one of the big themes of tectonic shifts is that financial markets have evolved over decades away from a focus on asset liquidity to a focus on funding liquidity. Could you elaborate on this shift and comment on how it affects the stability of our financial system?
Well, I have to, I guess I'm a little bit of a fuddy-duddy in this because I go back to my early days of going to school here and taking a course in credit analysis and being in commercial banking. But the traditional liquidity that we originally thought of as analysts was on the asset side of the balance sheet. Your cash, your investments, temporary investments in commercial paper or bankers, except or treasury bills that as a business you had there, the turnover of your inventory and the liquidity of your receivables. Those were key items. That was it. Yeah. But now, as the decades evolved, there we were, and liquidity became your access to liabilities. The extent to which you could issue commercial paper, the lines of credit that were open to you on the liability side, the speed with which you could issue bonds and so on. And the asset side became much less important. It was liabilities that became the source of liquidity, not purely the asset side of the balance sheet. A complete shift, to say the least. And that is still, I think, deeply embedded in most of the, in most people who are chief financial officers.
Okay. Do you think that the U.S. financial system is safer or less safe today than it was a decade ago? And going forward, what's the most important thing we can do to make it safer?
Well, this is, it's 2008 versus the present. That's what you're asking me to do. Sure, we're somewhat better off than in 2008. Really, there's no doubt about that. Things have calmed down somewhat. But if you look at what's going on, you can say, yes, the commercial banks in the United States are better than they were in 2008, 2009. That isn't much of a statement. We still don't have AA or AAA commercial banks that are rated that way. And at the same time, if you look at the key demanders of credit, for example, business corporations, I haven't heard of any business corporation whose credit quality has been moved to AA or AAA. Today, we have, I think, only one or two business corporations rated AAA in the United States. Johnson & Johnson is one, and I don't know whether it's AT&T, the other. Exxon lost its AAA rating a year or so ago. In the 1980s, there were 61 business corporations rated AAA. They're gone. They're around, those corporations. But then if you look at the extent to which what corporations have been doing in the United States, if you examine, for example, a couple of items on the extent to which corporations have improved, what have they done with their earnings, for example, and with their borrowings. Corporations have heavily used their earnings and their borrowings, and they've used that and borrowing to leverage and buy other entities. So in terms of the balance sheet improvement of business corporations over the last 20 years or so, that hasn't taken place. The balance sheet has not improved. And you can look through it. And if you examine, of course, there's a lot of talk about business corporations having liquidity that is stored outside the United States. True enough. But that liquidity is heavily domiciled in relatively few businesses. It is not widely spread. The drug industry, pharmaceuticals, the high-tech companies have. Don't tell me that it is diffused all over the United States that own a lot of liquidity outside the United States. It's not true. Business corporations have leveraged themselves more in the last two, three decades, and that really improved their liquidity position. And if you look, for example, at the number of corporations that are now rated BBB or lower, it's increased a lot as a percentage of total corporate debt outstanding. Now, I would say at some point in time in the future, those corporations are going to become more vulnerable unless we are going to have a new era of financial stability. And I'm not so sure that's in the offing.
Henry, you've been highly critical of the Federal Reserve. What do you see as the central bank's major blind spots?
I got to be careful with Paul sitting here. But I will I will talk around Paul. He's not been the blind spot. He's been the shining light. But, well, I think one of the great shortcomings of the central bank, well, the central bank has done a lot of positive things. I worked at the Federal Reserve for about 5 years, and they're dedicated people. They're hardworking. And you have to give them credit. They really work at what they're doing. However, having said that, the Federal Reserve also has their greatest accomplishments has been that we have not had a depression. And not having a depression is quite an accomplishment. The Federal Reserve also came to bail out a lot of areas of problem abroad and in the United States. I don't have to enumerate them. But the Federal Reserve did not understand and perceive the significance of structural changes in the United States for the financial markets and for the economy. It did not. And to give you just a couple of examples, the Federal Reserve did not really adequately analyze what the implications would be for the economy, for the financial markets, for the conduct of monetary policy as a result of the enormous growth of derivatives, financial derivatives, and the securitization of the mortgage market. The implications of it. Those instruments proliferated, the markets grew very rapidly. No one really sat down within the Federal Reserve and said, now listen, these instruments can be very important, but they're going to increase the growth of credit very rapidly and have some impact on the economy and financial market. I'll give you a second example. I don't think the Federal Reserve really evaluated very carefully what the implications would be for the removal of the Glass-Steagall Act. The initial desire was we'll remove the Glass-Steagall Act, the markets will be competitive, and this will benefit borrowers, institutions, and the economy. It did not really say, that no one stood up at the Federal Reserve and said, this is going to increase financial concentration in the United States. In the 1990s, the 10 largest financial institutions in the United States had about 10% of financial assets. Now it's over 80%. Now financial concentration has tremendous impact on competition, on the distribution of credit, and presents enormous problems to the central bank once it was achieved. There should have been a position paper by somebody at the Federal Reserve that would have stated both sides of the case. It's a very strange thing. You can't blame one party versus another here. The three people that participated significantly in the removal of the Glass-Steagall Act was Larry Summers, Greenspan, and who was the other one? Rubin. Thank you very much. Bob Rubin. Democrats and Republicans. So don't blame one side for doing this. It was both sides. It occurred under a Democratic administration. It was an enormous mistake that there wasn't more detailed analysis, deep thinking about what would happen to our banking system. Our banking system consolidated, and the smaller institutions, I know what will happen now. A lot of attention will be paid to smaller institutions and liberalizing and not putting as many restraints on them. I think that's very nice, but in the scheme of things, for the American economy, it will mean very little, because those smaller institutions are such a small fraction of financial and economic activity in the United States. It will look good politically, but its impact will be minor.
Henry, I'm going to, with an eye on the clock, I'm going to ask one more question. Okay. And then I'm going to invite everybody to join us downstairs at the reception. This also relates to the Federal Reserve. The book has a wonderful section in which you describe episodes in which Presidents Johnson and Nixon compromised the independence of the Federal Reserve. How do you see things going forward? Will President Trump's appointees to the Board of Governors be credibly committed to price stability?
I would hope so.
Will the executive branch exhibit the self-restraint needed to support Fed independence? Well, what about legislative self-restraint?
Well, as you know, President Trump has an enormous opportunity to influence the future of the central bank. There are a number of governors' chairs that are now open. He can make the appointments, whoever he wants, and they have to be approved by Congress, by the Senate. The chair of the Federal Reserve expires in January of next year, the term. So he has another opportunity. And this will be the first chair since modern day central banking starting in 1951 started that will not have served two terms. President Trump has already indicated last year he would not reappoint Janet Yellen. Now, if you go back from McChesney Martin's day on to the present time, McChesney Martin was not a trained economist, but he took a lot of courses at Columbia towards a PhD, and he had been chairman of the of the New York Stock Exchange. He worked at the U.S. Treasury. I think he had at the Export-Import Bank. So he was well-versed in financial markets. We had only one chair of the Federal Reserve that came from industry. And this was the man from Textron.
G. William Miller.
Bill Miller. And Bill Miller was in that job, I think maybe 15 months. And President Carter had to practically fire him. And I'll come back to this in a minute. But then thereafter, all the chairs, of course, going back, have been trained economists, one way or the other. Now the question is, what will President Trump do come the end of this year? Will he look for another trained economist, or will he look for a banker or an industrialist to put in that job? I have no answer to that as such. But there is an issue here. Paul Volcker was called in 1979.
Yeah.
In August or so of 1979, to take over an assignment that seemed Herculean at the time, because Bill Miller couldn't understand the issues, and neither did Arthur Burns, who was a trained economist and of great distinction, chairman of the Council of Economic Advisers, National Bureau, specialist, and expert on business cycles. He couldn't grab the reins. Well, Paul did grab the reins and did the dirty work. A very difficult job. I have to say this in his presence. Paul was not, when he was chairman, that popular. Who's going to be that popular when you take away the punch bowl and you restrain credit and you raise interest rates and so on? Very hard work, lonely work in a sense. He was not the popular individual that Alan Greenspan, or noted individual that Alan Greenspan, who became really a cult kind of figure, completely different. I think it's in the book. I have to tell you, I walked into his office one time, in the outer office, when he was chairman, and there were all these bricks lined up in the outer office. And I asked his secretary, what's this all about? Well, he got this from the bricklayers' union with a note saying they don't need this anymore. They don't need this anymore. You know, and that is hard work when you have to restrain. It is not hard work when you accommodate. You become very popular when you accommodate. Everybody loves you. The stock market loves you. The bond market loves you. The investment bankers are happy with you. But when you have to say no, that's when you become the disciplinarian that a central banker should be able to impose. And very few have stood to meet that task. I give Paul credit for doing that.
Well, first of all, I hope you'll join me in thanking Henry for this wonderful experience. We have a very small token of appreciation for Henry, and it's a pen to write his next book. So we look forward to having that next book launch here as well.
Thank you.
But right now, we hope you'll join us downstairs in the Gardner Commons. That's M1100. It's one floor down. There will be people to guide you. And you will find there copies of Tectonic Shifts that are signed. And we look forward to chatting with you down there. Thank you very much for coming tonight.